Hello, dear students. So after discussing about the states of matter, the various states of matter and the interconversion of various states of matter, today I'll discuss about some another very interesting phenomena, and that is known as evaporation. Although I have given you a small introduction about evaporation in the earlier lecture also, so there is a small difference between the process of evaporation and vaporization. I hope you must be remembering, of course, that evaporation is what? Evaporation is conversion of liquid to vapor state at any temperature below the boiling point of the liquid. So how you define evaporation? Evaporation is conversion of liquid to vapor state at the temperature lower than the boiling point of liquid. Whereas vaporization, you know, is the conversion of liquid to vapor at its boiling point specifically, right? Another interesting aspect about evaporation. Evaporation is said to be a surface phenomenon. The process which occurs only on the surface of the liquid. That's why evaporation is known as surface phenomena. On the other hand, if you talk about vaporization, vaporization is what? It is bulk phenomena. It is a process which not occurs only on the surface of the liquid, it occurs on the whole bulk, right? So that is the basic difference, another difference between evaporation and vaporization. Now you must be wondering that why am I so much specific about the process of evaporation, because evaporation is a very important phenomena, and with this evaporation, number of our daily life observations are associated with that, right? So, in order to understand the process of evaporation, let's see what are the factors that decide the rate of evaporation. So, here the first factor which decides the rate of evaporation is, of course, temperature. So, what is the effect of temperature on evaporation, right? Higher is the temperature, faster is the rate of evaporation, right? And again, you can observe it in your daily life activities. When you wash your clothes and leave them for drying, then you see that your clothes get dried faster in summer seasons rather than in winter seasons. Reason? Because in summers, the rate of evaporation is higher than that of during winter seasons, right? And another factor is the factor that is surface area. As I already said, that evaporation is the surface phenomena. That's why it is directly dependent on surface area. So what we say here is again that surface area is also directly proportional to rate of evaporation. More is the surface area, faster is the rate of evaporation. And again, you can see that if you have your wet clothes and if you fold them and keep them aside, even in sunlight also, and on the other hand you have your wet clothes and spread them in bright sunlight, then what happens? Which clothes will be drying up faster? of course, the one which you have opened up and spread, right, instead of the clothes that you have kept folded in sunlight. The reason, when you spread your clothes, the surface area increases, and when the surface area increases, the rate of evaporation also increases, right? Then another factor here is wind speed. Again, the rate of evaporation is directly proportional to wind speed. Faster is the speed of wind, faster is the rate of evaporation. And again, same thing you can observe in your daily life activities, that during rainy season, when your clothes don't dry up easily, what you do, you spread them in the room or under some shaded area and switch on the fan. So when you switch on the fan, your clothes get dried very quickly. Why? Because on increasing the wind speed, the two things happen. When you increase the wind speed, the kinetic energy of particles is increasing and the rate of evaporation is increasing. And other thing, when we switch on the fan, it removes away the moisture or the humidity content in the surrounding atmosphere. And as the surrounding atmosphere is becoming drier, the rate of evaporation is increasing, right? Then one more factor that decides the rate of evaporation is humidity. Humidity is the factor which adversely affects the rate of evaporation. So we say that humidity is inversely proportional to rate of evaporation. More is the humidity, less is the rate of evaporation. But what is humidity? Humidity is what? The water content in the form of water vapors in the atmosphere, or the moisture content of the atmosphere, is known as humidity. If your atmosphere is already saturated with water vapors, it will not extract more water from the liquid part, or more vapors from the liquid part, and in that case the rate of evaporation will decrease, right? Again, this you can observe, and you must have observed in your daily life, that your clothes don't get dried up easily during rainy season, although the temperature is high. On the other hand, your clothes get dried up very quickly in winter season, even though the temperature is low, because in winters there is less moisture content or the air is almost dry. But during rainy season, when the air is already saturated with water vapors or moisture, then the rate of evaporation, it slows down to a great extent, and your clothes don't get dried up easily, right? Then one more factor that decides the rate of evaporation is the nature of liquid. Nature of liquid, here we talk about the strength of intraparticle force of attractions. Strength of interparticles force of attraction is also inversely proportional to the process of evaporation. Stronger are the interparticle force of attractions, less easily the liquid is converted to vapor state, and less is the rate of evaporation. For example, if you take three petri dishes, and in one you take, say, 5 ml of alcohol, or you can take some perfume. In another one, you take say 5 ml of water, and in another one you take some oil, 5 ml of oil, maybe some cooking oil or anything like that. Then you leave them open atmosphere in the same room. So what you observe, that this alcohol or perfume, whatever you have taken, it gets evaporated fastest and the petri dish is free, right? You don't observe any liquid left over here. For water to get dried up completely evaporated, it takes comparatively longer time. And in oil, it is going to take a very, very long time for it to get completely evaporated. And you may say that the complete evaporation not occurs at room temperature easily in case of oil. Why? Because the interparticle force of attraction in alcohol are weakest. That's why it gets evaporated fastest. In water, the interactions are comparatively stronger, so it gets evaporated but to a slower rate, right? And in case of oil, what happens? In oil, the interparticle force of attractions are very, very strong and they don't get evaporated easily, right? So the liquid which is having a weaker interparticle force of attraction, where rate of evaporation is high, that liquid is known as volatile liquid. And as the strength of interparticle force of attraction increases, the ease of evaporation decreases, and we say the volatility of the liquid also decreases, right? So stronger are the interparticle force of attraction, lesser is the rate of evaporation, and lesser is the volatility of the liquid, right? So here are the factors that decide the rate of evaporation. Temperature directly proportional. Higher is the temperature, higher is the rate of evaporation. Surface area directly proportional. More is surface area, more is the rate of evaporation. Wind speed, higher is the wind speed, higher is the rate of evaporation. More is the humidity, less is the rate of evaporation. And stronger are the interparticle force of attractions, lesser is the extent of evaporation, right? Now, why are we discussing in so much in detail about evaporation? What is its importance? It has got number of interesting phenomena in our daily life that are explained only on the basis of evaporation. And this evaporation also has number of important consequences, and the most important effect of evaporation is the cooling effect of evaporation. Evaporation gives us a cooling effect, right? So how it gives you a cooling effect? There are so many examples that you have seen that explain that evaporation gives you a cooling effect. For example, if you spray some perfume on your skin, then what happens? It gives you a cooling effect, isn't it? Right. Why it gives you a cooling effect? Because the liquid present in perfume is a highly volatile liquid. As soon as it comes in contact with your skin, it absorbs energy from your skin and it gives you a cooling effect. So what is the exact process of this evaporation, and why is it known as surface phenomena, and why is it giving you a cooling effect? For that, let's take an example. So here, suppose we have some liquid in a container, and as you know, The particles of liquid are continuously moving, randomly moving. They collide each other, and this collision of liquid particles, this collision is elastic. What do you mean by elastic collision? Elastic collision means during the collision, the total energy is conserved. When the two particles hit each other, the total energy of the two particles before hitting and after hitting is conserved. It may happen that when two particles are colliding, one of the particle may lose energy and the another particle may gain energy. But the energy lost by one particle is exactly equal to the energy gained by another particle, right? One thing. Another thing, when these particles are getting energy, the more energetic they become, the more tendency they have to move on the surface, right? So here we can say the particles present at the liquid surface are the particles that are most energetic. These are having maximum amount of energy. So suppose some other particle from the bulb, it comes and hits to a particle on the surface. And during this collision, suppose this particle provides some more energy to the particle on the surface, then what happens? The particle has such a sufficient amount of energy that it can overcome the interparticle force of attraction and it can be easily converted to vapor state. So for breaking down these interparticle force of attraction, where this particle is getting energy, this particle is getting energy from its own system only, right? And in turn, in order to overcome its loss of energy, the system will absorb energy or heat from the surroundings. And as the surrounding is losing energy, that's why surrounding is getting cooled down. And we say that your evaporation process is giving you a cooling effect. There are so many examples from our daily life that provide us a direct evidence about the cooling effect of the process of evaporation. One I have already discussed, that if you sprinkle or spray some perfume on your skin, you get a cooling effect, right? Because the particles of perfume or alcohol, they take energy from our skin, and as they are taking energy from our skin, they are providing us a cooling effect, right? Another one, when you are in a hurry to rush to school and your mom gives you a cup of hot milk and you are getting late, then what you do? Yes, what you do, you take some saucer or bowl and you pour the hot milk in that so that it gets cooled up faster and you can easily drink it, right? Why so? When you put that milk in a saucer or in a shallow bowl, then what happens? The surface area of this liquid increases. As the surface area increases, as you know, evaporation is a surface phenomena. As the surface area increases, the rate of evaporation increases. More is the evaporation, more is the cooling effect. And your hot material gets cooled down easily and you can easily sip it over. Right? So many examples. You are always advised to wear cotton and light colored clothes during summer. Why? Light colored because the light color is a reflector of heat. It does not absorb more of heat, rather it reflects back the heat. One thing. And why cotton clothes? Because cotton clothes are the absorber of sweat. So that they bring the sweat to the surface, they absorb it, they bring the sweat to the surface, and this surface because of the more energy, the sweat here gets evaporated, and this evaporation gives you a cooling effect. That's why you feel comfortable wearing cotton clothes during summers, right? One more example you can take that gives you a clear-cut reflection about the cooling effect of evaporation. In summers, you must have seen you get some earthen pot or earthen matka. In that you put some water and the water gets cooled down. But at the same time, if you put some water in a plastic container or in a steel bucket, then what happens? Although the two things are kept at the same room temperature, but the water kept in earthen pot gets cooled down easily, but not the water kept in iron bucket or steel bucket or plastic bucket. Reason? Because if you look carefully to the earthen pot, you can observe the very fine holes over there. And through these holes, the water gets evaporated, and this evaporation causes cooling. But same evaporation is not possible in the plastic or steel containers, and that's why the water doesn't become cool, right? Another example you can see, you must have seen the use of desert coolers during summers. These desert coolers, they work very well during summers, but they don't work during rainy season, right? So how do these desert coolers work? Desert coolers, what do they do? You must have seen the container of the desert coolers filled with water. When you switch it on, there is a pump which lifts up the water and spreads it to all the parts of the cooler. Then what happens? This water, it absorbs the energy from your from the air present in the room and gets evaporated, and so that the air inside the room gets cooled down. But the same desert cooler doesn't work during rainy seasons. Why? During rainy season, the atmosphere is very humid. The air is already saturated with water vapors or moisture, and due to that, the rate of evaporation has decreased to a great extent. As there is no evaporation, there is no cooling effect, right? So another example that gives you an idea that evaporation causes cooling. Let's take one more example. You must have seen during winters, people sprinkling water over the rooftops or on the lawns or on the roads. Why? Because water is a liquid which has very high heat of vaporization. When you sprinkle water on rooftops or lawns or on the roads, then what happens? This water absorbs a large amount of heat for getting evaporated, right? As the water is evaporated by absorbing heat from the surroundings, of course the surroundings, they get cooled down. So you keep thinking, you will get so many examples showing you that how evaporation is useful for us and how it causes a cooling effect, right? Another important thing that I would like to discuss with you here is about the dry ice. You must have heard the name dry ice. So what is dry ice? Dry ice is the common name given to solidified carbon dioxide gas. As you have seen in our earlier lectures that the solids on heating are converted to liquids, and liquids on further heating on converted to vapors. At the same time, there is a possibility if we take a container fitted with a movable piston and we have some gas in it, and if we apply pressure on the piston, by applying pressure, what we are doing? We are bringing the water molecules of the gas to come closer, and it may happen that the particles are now so closed that they develop a stronger force of attraction, and now we can say the gas state has been converted to liquid state, right? And by exerting some more pressure over here, it is also possible that this liquid, on further exerting pressure, makes the particles to come closer, even more closer, so that the liquid state is converted to solid state, right? In carbon dioxide, what happens? When you exert pressure on carbon dioxide, instead of getting converted to liquid state, it is directly converted to solid state. And now that process, as we have already discussed, is known as sublimation, right? So if we take solid carbon dioxide and if we heat solid carbon dioxide, it is directly converted to carbon dioxide gas without getting converted into liquid state. So if you hold some solidified carbon dioxide in your hand, what will you observe? You will feel that it gives you a cooling effect. Why cooling effect? Because solid is getting converted to gas. For that process, it is absorbing energy from your skin, and because of that, it is giving you a cooling effect. That's why it feels cold, and that's why we call it ice. But why dry? Because during this state, there is no change in liquid state. And in that case, your hands don't get wetted. You don't get that wetting effect. And that's why that is known as dry. So as it is not giving you any wetting effect, that's why it is known as dry. And it is giving you a cool feeling, and that's why it is known as ice. The dry ice is the common name used for the solidified carbon dioxide, right? So with this, that is all about the first chapter of your chemistry syllabus, that is matter, inner surroundings. Next, we'll be discussing in our next lecture. Have a nice time and goodbye till then.